But the topic that I wanted to talk about is regulation, something that we talk about a lot as libertarians, but that I think we are sort of misconstruing or misunderstanding a little bit. The whole presentation really goes to show that fact, if you will. So we'll start a little bit with what we do know, and
I can get this working.
Yeah, what we know, and then I'll move into why what we know might not actually be accurate, and then how we probably should interpret regulations instead. This is important because regulations are a lot worse than even we in this room think. At least I think so. And so obviously, as libertarians, we think they're really bad. A lot worse than most people do. So if it's even worse than we think, then it's really horrible. So what do we know? Well, we know that regulations are destructive. I think we can all sign up on that, right? This is nothing new. Even progressives would claim that some regulations are destructive. We know that regulations limit entrepreneurship as well. It provides us with fewer opportunities. There are fewer areas in the market where entrepreneurs can start businesses, where they can offer products and services and so forth, right? The opportunities that are out there are probably a little less valuable, which is also a problem, of course, because that means that there's less motive for entrepreneurs to do their thing in the economy. This means also that there will be less innovation. Obvious problem. I saw an article, I think, on BlueRockwell.com many years ago with the title saying something like, in the year 3500, subtitle, or that's where we would be without the state. Right, so obviously this has an effect on economic development and our standard of living as well. So it's important that we understand regulations. So that's what I said, okay. Of course, another important aspect of this is that we really don't like government. Not at all. And I think Ken Lee did a good job summarizing some of the reasons why government sucks. Just put it in brief terms, okay? And what we do know as well is Frederick Bastiat's story about the seen and the unseen. And I think that's a very powerful story that I think we use a lot. I use it when I teach. I know many other people in academia use it, and good people in academia, I should say. Many of them are not. They use it as well, because it's a powerful story about how to properly analyze the market and the economy. So we usually do that. I mean, how many of you are familiar with the parable of the broken window? See, so basically everybody but three or four. Right, so it is a powerful story, and no one is a better storyteller than Frederick Bastiat, probably. Okay, so I'll summarize his story a little bit to show you where we should understand regulations, how we should understand them better, and why they are such a disaster. So in his story, there is this baker and a boy playing with a rock. And the boy throws the rock through the window and crashes the window. So the window is broken. A lot of people gather around and they say at first, oh, naughty boy, you can't do that. And then someone has a great idea that, wait a minute, this means that the baker has to buy a new window. That means more business for the glacier. That's a good thing, right? And that means the glacier has more money, so he can buy a dress for his wife. I'm making this up, this is not actually from Bastiat, but so the boutique owner gets a little more income as well. That's a good thing, right? So the boutique owner can now buy a PC because he sold this extra dress that he wouldn't have sold were it not for this board. Right? So the tech salesman gets another sale as well, so he can buy some flowers. And you can sort of tell that my wife is here. Buys a dress for wife, buys flowers. But buying flowers is also a business, right? Because the florist can sell those flowers, and he gets a little more business. Isn't this fantastic? So maybe we should destroy a little more. I mean, that's what someone like Walt Krugman would say. Let's destroy stuff every day, because then we get a lot of economic growth. And Keynesians talk about this, right? We have the magnifier effect, where we can just sum all these things together, and wow, isn't there a lot of economic activity and a lot of wealth creation just because of this initial destruction?
Yeah.
Right? That's where we start out. That's the scene. But to Frederick Bastiat, what we need to focus on as good economists is the unseen. What would have taken place were it not for this broken window? Yeah. Right? And that's a completely different chain of events, a different chain of transactions. If the window is intact, the baker would not need to spend his money on buying a window, because he doesn't want a spare window. Instead, he would do something else. So he would buy a pair of shoes, for instance. Well, that means that the shoemaker has a little more income, which means that he can buy pork, and this is not political pork, this is actual. This means then that the farmer can get a little more income as well. So you can buy a place. For this example, the lumber guy gets a little more business as well. So he can buy an armchair, and you see where this is going, right? It's the same kind of chain of transactions. So we have one chain going one way, one chain going the other way, so that whether the window is broken or not, there's still a magnifier effect. It's the seen or the unseen, and we need to compare the two to figure out the actual effects, right? We still know this. So the intuitive analysis here then is, okay, so let's calculate the differences. This is a little difficult because we don't know exactly how to do this. Do we just focus on the market value of the window that was lost? Is that the difference? Or is it sort of the net difference between each transaction in these chains? Or is it the window plus the net gain in each transaction? Or is it something else? Or do they always even out? I've seen that as well. How do we actually compare this? It's not all that easy. Now, the better analysis is really to not consider the chains at all, but rather simply state the fact that, yeah, the window was destroyed. Right? That is the loss of value. Whatever happens later, that's just the workings of the market. Right? Since this is a new situation, after the boy crashes the window, the baker updates his preferences. Right? Had he had the window, he would have bought shoes. Since he doesn't have a window anymore, he has different preferences. So the most valuable action that he can take is to buy the window. If the window is intact, the most valuable action he can take is buy the shoes. So after the window is broken, it doesn't necessarily mean that shoes is the most valuable after the window. Everything can change, right? So the chains could still be value maximizing, except for the initial loss, right? So in a sense, destruction is really a temporary setback. And it's a temporary setback for the baker in this case, since he loses the window. But after the setback, everybody's still acting according to their preferences. They're still doing what they consider is valued more. Right? This is what the market is about. We have all these options and we choose whichever is the most valuable to us, whether or not something was destroyed. Of course, this is a problem we can talk about. Does the baker get restitution from the boy? Does it get to lock the boy up in the basement to work for him until he's paid off the window? All of these things, right? But in terms of economics, this is a temporary thing. Right? The window's gone, okay. People move on, they do whatever they think is most valuable from that point, right? Maybe could be the case that the boy found crashing the window the most valuable course of action. Now, what I argue is that regulation is very different from this. So, regulation is destructive, as I had on the previous slide, but it's not destruction. And that's different. Because usually we in this room, I think, will argue that regulation destroys. And that is true. But regulation is actually a lot worse than destroying stuff. And that's the point I want to make during this presentation. Because regulation is not actually a temporary setback. Regulation does not destroy the window and then let everybody move on as before. Rather, it's permanent. It's a prohibition for certain types of actions. Right? It doesn't mean that people's preferences are changed immediately. They might still want to do what is prohibited, but they cannot. So they have to pursue instead what they value less than their most highly valued course of action. But what this means is that people are no longer maximizing the value of their actions, which is very different from destruction, when you replace the window and then everybody moves along as usual and they maximize their choices. They do whatever is most valuable to them. So let's go through this a little bit. So this is the previous chain of events. But in this case, let's add a little bit of regulation, just for the heck of it. And again, now you see why it's important to realize that this is actual pork, a political pork. Political pork would not be illegal, of course. Okay, so if buying pork is illegal, if that is regulated, it means the shoemaker cannot buy pork for his extra income anymore. Right? So this whole chain goes away. Gone. This means instead that the shoemaker does something else, of course. He could save the money, he could buy some other good that he would like, or he could buy a dress for his wife, or whatever it is. But this is necessarily of lower value than the action he would have chosen. Still wants the pork. So he has not updated his preferences. He's not choosing what he values most, he's choosing what he values second most. That's a big difference, right? Because it's not value maximizing anymore, because that option was taken away from him, right? And as long as he and others value pork more than other options, they lose value because they have to choose something else, right? As long as the preferences are the same, as long as they value buying pork more highly than all the other options, they lose because they have to pick something of lesser value. Now that sucks. So in every transaction where pork is more highly valued, there is a loss. And this is sort of true. I mean, as long as people don't update their preferences so that they just exclude pork from the equation, there's a loss of value. But it could also be the case, of course, that someone starts to value pork more. So you would possibly have black markets and so forth, right? So the loss lingers and it keeps affecting people potentially every day for as long as there is this prohibition on pork. This also means that people start producing other things. If pork is illegal, then obviously farmers with pigs are going to do something else. They're going to start investing in cows or what have you, other animals. Maybe they will have an orchard to grow pears. So this means that since this does not no longer reflect people's maximizing choices, what they actually value, the production capabilities of the whole market are going to be distorted towards an inefficient state. So the new transaction chains that happen are actually, in a sense, artificial, because people are forced to choose something different than the value. This is a fundamental distortion of the market, because this is not only how people choose things, but it's also the income of the people who wanted to produce what they were producing, but are no longer allowed to produce, right? So in a sense, the social opportunity cost in the market, as what is valued by people in general, they don't no longer reflect people's actual choices and what people actually value. I'm seeing how big this problem is, right? Suddenly the market does no longer reflect what people want. It reflects something else, something less. Okay? And instead, we satisfy wants that people do not value as highly. So this also means that since production changes, the farmers no longer produce the pigs for pork, they've invested in something else. What this means is that people are presented with different options. Right? When production changes, obviously pork is not an available option to them anymore. Instead, they're producing stuff that is of lesser value to people. So a lot of these options that would have existed, that people would have chosen, that people would have wanted to buy or trade for or produce or whatever, they remain unrealized. So all of these things that we would have wanted in the year 3500, right, but we're not there because of regulation, it doesn't happen. And these are not simply pork, because these things are produced because pork is regulated. So with the prohibition of pork, people start producing other things, which distorts the whole production apparatus of the market. So the whole economy is distorted and deviates from where it would have been. So in a sense, people are robbed of a lot of choices, not only pork, but a lot of other things as well, because the market cannot supply these options for them anymore. So the extent of one single regulation is a whole lot more and a whole lot worse than we actually think at first. It's not only that we lose this option, but it affects all the other options available to us, and they're all of lesser value. So let's use an example to just see where this is going. So we have the scene for sweatshops, and the scene here would be, think of any progressive friends, if you still have any. The scene of the sweatshop is, of course, a terrible working conditions. It's the low pay, it's all the hazards, the danger of working in the sweatshop. Poor people having these terrible jobs. I mean, I would definitely not choose to produce sneakers instead of my cushy job in the university. That's the scene. Of course, the unseen that we often use as an argument for sweatshops is that, well, what are the other options? Right? Why do they choose to work in sweatshops? And some have shown, Ben Powell has shown, for instance, that, yeah, they're lining up, they're queuing to get these jobs because they value them so freaking highly compared to all the options. Generally, the options are, as we know, prostitution, starvation, or toiling on a barren field, things like that. So working in a sweatshop is a whole lot better than the other option. Now you're with me so far, right? The seen and the unseen, the sweatshops. But what about the unrealized? The real question is not, okay, what are the real options they're presented with, but what options would they have been presented with were there no regulations? Sort of the free market story, right? That's where they would have been had it not been for regulations. Could be the prohibition of pork, could be any regulation, right? But then, of course, how do we argue this to non-libertarians? Is it just our wishful thinking, or can we somehow know what their options would have been? Not really. But what we do know is that there's not really anything stopping sweatshops from being there. I mean, in terms of the economy. So there's no lack of the technological capacity or the technological capabilities for having a sweatshop. It's obviously there and it's working in some sense. Right? So the technology and the capital is there. Okay. We know the labor is there because people are working there. So that's also not a problem. It's not a problem of government haven't educated people enough. People are there and they're obviously skilled enough for these types of jobs. There's also no lack of supply chains. So suppliers to sweatshops, whatever customers they have, the materials they use, the machinery they use, they are there. Right? The infrastructure is there. So obviously Nike can produce sneakers in Vietnam or whatever, and then ship them back to the US and sell them in the US. Obviously it works. So there should be more sweatshops, right? The real options for people would be between sweatshops. Considering what the market looks like right now, why aren't there just a bunch of sweatshops? Why are the options sweatshop or prostitution? The options should be between sweatshop one, sweatshop two, and sweatshop three. And they should be competing for the labor, which means raising wages, having better working conditions, and so forth, right? That's where we would have been, because there's nothing in the market actually stopping them from this. So there's something wrong here, right? The big value differential between the sweatshop job, which we might, you might not value personally, and the second best option, prostitution, since this is so such a big difference, because you probably agree with me that in a free and open market, there would be several alternatives that are sort of the same, right? They would choose between different jobs in different factories. They wouldn't choose between a job in one factory and prostitution. So there is a problem here. Something is messing things up in the market, right? This could be simply a temporary effect, simply because the country is developing. Of course, if I build a new factory, then it's going to be the only factory until Ken builds his factory. That could be one potential explanation. It could be that the government has given this sweatshop a privileged situation, so they have monopoly and so forth, right? We know this. But there are also these indirect effects. So there are these artificial transaction chains that we talked about before that are stripping people of their options. They're losing these options because of regulations elsewhere. It's not because the government has necessarily regulated the sweatshop per se. It's just the fact that government is present in the market at all. That strips people of their options and it hinders economic development. So it keeps them poor, basically. So the loss of value by regulation is permanent, and it's actually everywhere. It affects the whole market and how the market works and all the options presented to us in the market. Every time we make a choice, we feel the loss due to regulation somewhere. And of course, since it's regulation, unless we update our preferences, we will lose every time we choose, because we need to choose the second best option and not the best option. And very often when we talk about regulation, we tend to overlook how these indirect regulations affect people and people's choices, especially poor people in poor countries, because they don't have the options that they otherwise would have had. And they would have been richer than we are today. And I think it's important to remember that these artificial transaction chains caused by regulations, even if it seems like a very marginal, minimal regulation somewhere, they affect people's choices and valuations, and they affect production as well in the market. So they affect all the options presented to people, which means people choose differently. So it's not only the case that a valuable option is taken away from us, it's also that all the other options produced in the next stage, so to speak, all those options are of lesser value as well. So the impact of regulation, even if there is just one regulation in the market, that's going to strip all of us of a number of options that we otherwise would have had, which means we are poorer because of this fact. So the real counterfactual is always the completely free market. Right? It's not a matter of how much regulation. It's not a matter of 1 or 2 or 3,000 regulations. It's not a matter of how many laws do we have or how big is government. It's really a matter of, is there a government? Because if there is one, a lot of us, probably all of us, are stripped of the options we otherwise would have had, and we're poorer because of this. Right? So the impact is enormous. So I'll leave you with this thought, and I would encourage you to look at the whole argument, which is in my book. So I'm not selling it here, but take a look at this. And I'm actually using this when I'm teaching as well, looking at regulations and the effect of regulations on the economy, trying to understand how the economy is interdependent. Everything is interdependent and affects everything else in the economy. And I'll stop there. Thank you.